start webinar option. Okay, Natasha ma'am, are you trying to share screen with the PPT? You're muted, ma'am.
I'm trying to, but then I cannot get through.
So you're already on this screen, right? So you need to let your phone go and only keep your laptop on. If you can leave any one instrument needs to go, ideally your laptop should be with you. So if you can leave
the phone. If my laptop has an issue with the speaker.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, so I'm having difficulty. I don't know, somehow I cannot hear on my laptop.
Very good.
Okay. Okay. So let me just check if I've got the email. Yeah. Who is that?
Who has an Anka Saf Kurundo? Chocolate door pale bazia.
Yeah, Bangu.
Reshma, I have sent you it an email.
Tuka door, Kitlezai. Hello, good evening, everyone. We're very happy to see all of you who have joined this session so far. I think, Natasha, would you like to begin?
Yes, miss.
Yes.
I'll start, miss.
Yes, please, go ahead.
Good afternoon, all. A warm welcome to everyone on yet another amazing session on fine motor development organized by Early Childhood Association Goa in cooperation with Nirmala Institute of Education. I, Natasha Gonsalves, Secretary for ECA Goa, take this moment to thank ECA India for sharing their platform for this session. And now I call upon our territory head for ECA Goa, Mrs. Anna Coelho, to introduce the session.
Thank you very much, Natasha. So hello once again to all of you participants. We are very happy that all of you have registered for this session. On behalf of Early Childhood Association Goa, the Goa chapter, and on behalf of Nirmala Institute of Education, I welcome all of you to our second session of this academic year. Our first session was held last year in September for teachers, and we focused on art and craft activities. Today, we will be focusing on developing fine motor skills for preschool children. We're very happy that many parents have joined the session, and we hope that we can help you to do better with your child at home to develop their fine motor skills. We hope to conduct many more sessions during this year. And we hope you will join us for those sessions as well. We would like all of you to become members of Early Childhood Association because it will help us and it will help you. It will help you to become better teachers to your students, and also it will help you parents to become better parents while you're bringing up your preschooler. We will now play a short video to familiarize you with the work ECA is doing in our country. So please watch this video for a little while before we begin our session. Reshma, will you please put on the session? Thank you. Is there an audio for this? We're not getting the audio for this session.
I think today is a technical glitch day. So just kindly excuse it. I'll try to restart.
Early childhood development, early childhood care makes a huge difference. A difference that persists well into adulthood. It shapes who you become. At that age, 98% of the brain develops. New connections are formed. That will become the blueprint of the child for life. If at that age kids don't receive the right kind of care or learning, they will grow up with a few crayons missing from their life's pencil box. And why should that happen to any child?
children are the future. And that's true. But there is a fundamental problem with that idea. It suggests that they are just kids now. But later, when they become the future, we can start taking care of them with colleges and universities, a better economy, a better job climate. But that's wrong. A recent New York Times editorial poses the question, do we invest in prison or preschools? The answer is obvious. The most critical time that you have with children is right now.
Is not that we don't want to care for our children. People just need to know how. Parents, teachers, the government, all the stakeholders in the future of our children, we go about it on a trial by fire basis, learning each time as the child grows up. But we need a more structured, a more uniform way to do this. At the Early Childhood Association of India, that is our mission, to help the country invest in taking care of its youngest citizens.
Children go through a period of rapid learning in the first 5 years. The most embedded parts of their personalities, their attitudes, moral values, social values, their learning abilities, how they deal with people, how they deal with situations, good or bad, they are all a product of experiences that they have between the ages of 0 and 5. That's when they learn how to adapt and respond to the world. It's not going to happen overnight. We are looking at big changes, revolutionary changes, but we are taking baby steps. Still, if we can learn anything from these children, it's that baby steps can make a big difference if they are in the right direction.
To you, Natasha, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am Anna, and thank you, Reshma, for guiding us towards the Early Childhood Association, what exactly it is, so that I hope there are parents and teachers who would be interested in joining to make the difference and to make the change, especially for our little ones. And now I have Nandini, our Joint Secretary for ECA, to introduce our esteemed guest, Mrs. Anita Bhuchani.
Thank you, Natasha. Good evening, everyone. It gives me great pleasure to welcome Mrs. Anita Bhuchani, a school psychologist from the UAE. Anita joins us this afternoon from Abu Dhabi. Mrs. Anita Bhuchani has a background in clinical and school psychology. She has much passion for it as the 26 letters in the alphabet. Her master's in clinical psychology was the beginning of her exploration in the world of work, where she tasted teaching over the full spectrum of education. Along the way, she realized she enjoyed working with children and their caregivers. Soon, this became her inclination to work. And along with that, she also started working with the less privileged. She likes to share the knowledge she gained over the years to as diverse a population as possible. So here we are with Anita, who is passionate about psychology and education, to engage, empower, and facilitate us teachers and parents in this webinar. Thank you, Anita ma'am, for accepting our invitation. We look forward to a wonderful interaction with you. I'll just read a brief about this synopsis, what she's going to do today. With the birth of a baby begins the process of development, beginning with the opening of eyes and movement of limbs. As growth continues, so does transformation and learning. From lying on the back to turning to sitting up and later standing, walking, running, and exercising, the movement of the limbs continues. Let us dive into an hour of discovery and understanding. The who, what, when, where, why, and how of building fine motor skills in children, with Anita leading us through it. Get ready to rediscover and enhance our knowledge with listening, reflecting, and actively interacting through all of it. Once again, I welcome you, Anita, to this session. Over to you.
Thank you so much. I thank ECA at the very outset, each of the members who have taken an active role in inviting me and believing and trusting in me. I thank the audience, each one of you, for being here and ready to spend this 1 hour in the learning together. Let's get started.
I'm so sorry, Anita ma'am, to interrupt you. I will be sharing the PPT. Just guide me through it whenever you need me to start.
Sure. You can very well start now. So I'm sure we are all settled down, either because we are required to participate here, or we've come with the thought that maybe we might pick up something new that we can take back and use for our children at home or at school. I'm not going to let you sit that way. Let's get ready quickly to be visually presentable, if not for anything, but for my sake, so that I can see you as well as for your colleagues here. Shall we straighten our sari or dress, smoothen it? Shall we fix our tie, if at all we do wear one, or our dupatta, comb and brush our hair, apply lotion to our face, even lipstick or lip gel, flex ourselves a bit, considering that we have to stay seated for more than an hour. Maybe wiggle our toes, fingers, interlink our fingers, rub our hands, check that our keyboard or keypad is functioning well. Maybe a quick glance at your message on WhatsApp till, because you need to turn it off for about an hour. Or maybe have a run through your mailbox. Lots of things I made you do right now. What was happening here? What was happening? How did we get here? What was the process? Did we learn consciously, or did we have to practice all these skills to know how to do, what to do, and when to do? Shall we try and understand these skills? So as we move forward to our slides, through our slides, let's learn what skills are required for us to do all this. Did we require to move our body or just parts of it? Did we get up, sit down? What did we do? I'm sure all of us are aware of the terms gross and fine motor skills. So if at all we can have the presentation, please. Thank you. I'm sorry, I hate doing this, giving instructions regarding playing of slides, but we can move on to slide 2, please.
Just give me a minute, ma'am. Just give me a minute.
That's fine. Take your time. I really appreciate you offering to play it, because this gives me the leeway to actually do a lot of other things. Because I'm equipped here with plenty of stuff so that we can learn along the way. Yes. So as you see on the screen, what's happening? All the artwork, the drawing, everything that's happening, it does require a certain skill. It requires movement. It requires coordination. And as we progress through the slides, what are the skills that we need, as I said, to do all this? Do we need to keep moving our body, or do we need to just move a little bit? What did we just do? The activities that we just did, we moved parts of our body, right? So I'm sure each one is aware of the terms gross and fine motor skills. Say, for example, if we need to hold something, we are using our hand, holding a glass, maybe an apple or a straw, pounding. What does it require? All these are skills. Say, for example, visualize yourself or your child walking, standing, jumping, swinging, balancing, tiptoeing. Have you played tiptoe with your fingers? Think of that. Holding objects. These are gross and big movements. And some of them can be a combination of big, small, and even tiny movements. So as we can see on the slide, fine motor skills are activities in which you use the small muscles of your hands and wrists to make precise movements. And they are different from the gross or the bigger motor skills, which are like running, jumping, and uses larger muscles. So from the activities we did earlier that I asked you to do, can you take a minute to write them down under different headings? Headings like gross and fine skills. I'd like to give you a minute to do that. When you're writing, as I did once earlier, I did find an overlap somewhere. So I was wondering, is this gross or is this a fine motor skill? Which heading would it go under then? Say, for example, when I mentioned tiptoeing with your feet or with your fingers, what would you classify them as? Also, have you wondered how gross and fine motor skills are connected? How are they connected? And how do they support each other? So if you sit down to type, what is the first thing you do? Stabilize your trunk. You sit down, entrench yourself firmly in your seat. And then next, you align your posture. You sit upright and you try and do hold your neck, shoulders still. And only then can your wrists, hand, and fingers make the delicate, precise movements of typing. Try typing hunched forward. Leaning off to one side or hanging your head. Can you do that? Or letting your shoulders go slack. It's more difficult. You can probably do it, but it's a little more difficult. So gross motor skills, therefore, the development of these skills, the gross motor skills, is actually the sturdy foundation. So from moving, from holding a big object to holding finer objects. the big object holding is the foundation for being able to skillfully hold the smaller objects. And when you do activities that strengthen your baby's big muscles, you are not just supporting his or her movement skills, you're setting him up for success with drawing, cutting, brushing teeth, getting dressed, writing, and countless other fine motor skills. So as a child grows, we are told that there are milestones in development, which we can see on the third slide. These have been given to us as a prescription and for us to constantly refer to, just to be aware of the progress that our child or children make. How many of us are aware and consciously follow them and thereby get anxious? Let us understand the stages of development. So as we see on the next slide, it will show that the first year of life is what actually lays the foundation for fine motor development. What do you see on the screen? At about 2 months of age, babies realize that they have hands. Between 2 and 4 months, they'll see something and try to get it with their hands. They'll swipe at the toy, only occasionally hitting it, but accuracy will gradually improve. By 6 months, the baby won't bat at the toy or wave his arm about before landing on it. He will be able to do it instantly. Now he'll grab for that irresistible toy with a rake-like grasp. So he will just grab the way I was doing this. Earlier, it was only trying to get it. And then gradually it becomes being able to hold it using the entire hand. With an improvement on swiping, it is still primitive because it ignores his thumbs. It's because the hand motor development moves from the little finger upward to the thumb, actually. Try and notice it next time you're working with little ones, especially who are near newborns or just a few months old. So until now, the main interest in an object was getting it and then putting it in his mouth to explore it. So I grab an apple or even the glass and instantly it goes in my mouth. That's what a baby does, doesn't he or she? And say, for example, a spoon. At around 6 months of age, what is the baby likely to do with the toy or the spoon? Banging, shaking, tuck, 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 and keeps going on. And then we have things like these objects, which generally attract your attention. Something that also has a string that you can use to pull. And then gradually these toys are ones which will continue to be interested in. The babies will continue to be interested in these toys, not just because it was a means of grabbing and dragging them because it makes a sound, but also because it will help them in their skill building as they progress. So at 8 months, what will the baby do? The baby will start to strategize. Hold the spoon in front of his face, probably. If he sees that it is vertical, he knows he has to rotate his wrist as if preparing to maybe shake a hand. If it's horizontal, he will turn his wrist flat so he can grab it. He'll easily seize the spoon because he's mastered something which is called as anticipatory behavior. He anticipates being able to reach out, grab it, pick it up, and also to wield it. And just like that, your baby has hit a major milestone. What's that milestone? He has learned how to solve the problem of, I want that cool thing. How do I get it? He can do it. And as we progress through the next slide, we'll see what are the skills that we are actually preparing for. So the next 2 years, children spend them mastering these skills. All of these advancements not only help kids become more independent, but also teaches them fundamental lessons in problem solving, communication, and how the body works. Does that make sense, what I'm saying? So what are the skills? Along with fine motor development, the one thing that babies have to learn is finesse, going from the gross just grabbing to be able to grab properly and hold it and move their wrists along with it. If you've ever seen an infant grab a toy and then smack themselves in the face with it as they attempt to maybe get it in their mouth. So for example, if the child picks up the glass, the child has happened to grab onto it. The child will take it and then try to put it, but it just keeps coming in their face. We've seen that happen often, haven't we? And you've seen that it is not easy for them because they're still struggling. But finesse is especially important once the baby starts using the pincer grasp, that is using the, say, index finger and the thumb in coordination. And this is to pick up things like this, or maybe a cereal puff, and then they put it in their mouth. So if they apply too much force, say for example, this, if they apply too much force to this, since it is puffy and stuffed within with a soft center, when they apply too much pressure to it, it will burst and maybe it'll come all on their face. And of course it will become all crumbly. But learning to pick them up, pick these objects, even objects such as this, learning to pick them up is a skill. And it's half the skill. The other half is to be able to let go. Grab, but when do they let go? Have you noticed babies? They use different tactics and they start understanding it, right? So depending on the size and weight of the object and whether they want to put it on a table or throw it on the floor. How many times have we seen children just pick up and start throwing objects? It feels as if they get delighted just doing that. A curious sense of delight they get, and something which probably we cannot fathom. But they are constantly learning to grade their movements. And this is how we learn as children, that there is a difference between the amount of force used on, say for example, this versus this. The weight would be quite different, or maybe a lighter object, maybe an empty bottle, or something heavier. Is there anything heavy? Yes, there is. Say maybe a big bottle. They try and grab it. How much force will they need to throw this versus throwing this? A difference, right? And that's what we learn as children. Then from the age of 18 months, that is a year and a half, until their second birthday, children will be fascinated with the wonders of sculpting clay. That's when you can give them the molding clay or the clay dough or the play dough, as we call it, for them to run through. The best would be to use the atta at home. Just knead it into a dough and ensure you apply a bit of oil to it so that it's smooth enough and does not really keep sticking to them. Give it to them and let them keep playing with it. Is there any other food that you can think of? Maybe mash a banana and give it to them. Maybe give them some grapes, which they can actually crush and squeeze and then make a mess, but they will enjoy the feel of it on their fingers. Maybe you can give them some raisins. So they will keep squeezing it. They'll keep fidgeting with it and try and see what they can do with it. They will struggle and then they will master. Also, what they'll master is a form board puzzle. Maybe if it is like putting blocks together, and even this, for example, if it were separate, they would probably want to try and put them, stack them together, or to try and see how they would go together. They might even try and see how the string works. By the age of 3, they'll be able to work with a pair of scissors, supervised, of course, and get a floppy string. So for example, when you have to thread through something, for example, I have this edible ring, and you can help them string using a straw, which can gradually get more fine-tuned towards using smaller objects or smaller pipes, macaroni, the easiest thing. And then they'll be able to even give them maybe a string to run through their shoes. Give them an old shoe, ensure that it is washed clean and give it to them. And there you have it. That child is going to be busy for a fair good of time. And then they also figure out how to use one hand to hold a piece of paper still while using the other to color it with crayons. Don't be surprised if these relatively quiet activities leave your child exhausted and flustered. Remember that, especially if that bee just won't get on that string. Those smaller muscles tire quickly and easily. This is especially evident when the baby is learning to stack blocks. By age 1, let's say, she should be able to build a 4-block tower. We have these rings that we have the game, and we ask them to stack them one on top of the other. So they go about, maybe they don't put them in order, they put them in any order that they can think of, because they probably get attracted to a particular color, they use it. So that does not matter. The accuracy does not matter so much as the activity that they're actually able to insert the ring through the rod that is there. And by age 2, they should be able to use 6 blocks. So first a 4-block tower, then 6 blocks. And stacking the blocks, basically it requires not just the ability to pick up each block, but to release it gently and accurately. The idea is not the accuracy of sizes, but being able to actually put it on top of it. For example, if again, I go back to this, if they have to stack it, they need to put them all one on top of the other. And that needs to be balanced without it falling. It'll keep falling initially. And then gradually you will see that it stays. So over time, babies learn to manage the grasp, the timing, and the release necessary for stacking. So they'll pick it up, hold it, and hover over it, and then gradually put it. That is the process. Fine motor skills also, basically it gives you a chance to play games with your baby. What kind of games? So maybe rolling balls, we send the ball to the baby and the baby sends it back to us. That's the beginning of a conversation. Can you relate a story while throwing the ball and then getting it back? Can you involve the baby in the conversation, your child? I mean, I'm using the word baby just for the sake of using the term, but your child. So besides that, I'm sure each of us as parents, or sometimes even as teachers, we are required to keep a record of the baby's first steps, the baby's first word, which is at home. And then afterwards, when they come, we always give them in their progress report as well, don't we? So all these are memorable milestones. Maybe the walking, the running, these may drain you. But the fine motor skills are the ones that will make you feel, I can breathe now. Because know that one day your child is going to sit quietly and try to pop that raisin in his mouth. Or he'll spend hours with a coloring book. And finally, you get your time to finish that cup of coffee. And as we move on to the next slide, what are the examples of fine motor skills? Where do we need them? What are the activities that we do using fine motor skills? So we need fine motor skills, skill activities for things like maybe self-care activities like dialing the phone, turning doorknobs, keys, locks, putting the plug into a socket, buttoning and unbuttoning. I asked you to button up or to fix your tie, opening and closing zippers. That seems to be a fascination for children. They keep doing that because it gives them just such delight just doing that. And we as parents tend to get flustered. Oh my God, what's happening? Why is my child doing just this? But that's part of their development and learning. Fastening snaps and buckles, say tying shoelaces, brushing teeth, flossing, bathing, showering, using the toilet. Also remember, fine motor skills are required for activities of eating and cooking. So for example, picking up, like I said, small foods like raisins, eating with a fork and spoon, opening and closing containers. Have you seen your child keep opening and closing a box? They open it and then they want to close it back. Sometimes a bottle is fun. So they keep opening and they close, open and close. This seems to be a very fascinating activity for them. Even the Ziploc pouches, they may try and attempt all that. They will screw, unscrew lids, as I showed to you. They will use a ladle, tongs, or a large spoon to take a serving of food. Cutting food with a knife, say for example, you have cake and you have a plastic knife. Hand it over to your child and let the child go through that motion, because that is an activity that requires the fine motor skills, the movement of the wrist, as well as the eye-hand coordination factor. Even things like spreading jam, mayo, it can be a messy affair, I agree. But what's more important? The mess can get cleaned up. Will your child learn the activity? Will your child develop those skills that are necessary? What is important? That's your choice. Sprinkling spices. Be careful, of course, when you're using spices like chilies, black pepper, red pepper, it can harm. So be mindful of that. Also, pouring drinks. Have you seen children go fill up a bottle of water as much as they can hold and then try and pour it as well? So sometimes when you are at the table, you have a jug of water. The child is the one who wants to grab it and then want to pour it for you. You can guide the child, hold it for the child if it is too heavy for him or her, and then gently guide the child, because that is where the skills of, again, the movement, the precision, the accuracy that is required to pour it within the smaller container that it is being poured into. Even things like salad dressing, ketchup, all these things are there. So what about scrubbing and peeling fruits and vegetables? Have you tried, have you seen when you're peeling fruits and vegetables, or you've taken maybe a watermelon and you're chopping it? You will see a child slowly come over to you and sit and watch you and then want to also help you. allow your child to dig into the watermelon and squeeze it. Yes, the place will get messy. Try and keep a few newspapers or an old maybe chadar or something. Keep it handy. Keep it ready so that even if that gets messy, it's easy to get it washed. Also things like whisking. You know, we have this whisk that we have. It's either a egg beater or even the pav bhaji masher or anything else. All these are things that children love and they are fascinated by them. What are the other motor skills? Fine motor skills are also important for school activities, such as the pages of a book, turning the page. Don't we need a single or maybe a couple of fingers to be able to turn the page of a book? Coloring, drawing and painting, tracing, writing, cutting with scissors, pasting and gluing, measuring with a ruler, typing using a computer mouse pad, an iPad or a tablet, playing musical instruments. How many of you have seen or learned a musical instrument? How long does it take to be able to coordinate and follow the process in order to be able to actually play the music piece? Say, whether it's the guitar or the piano or the flute, it does require a lot of coordination. While playing, what are the activities or what is it that is included that which require fine motor skills? Say, shaking a rattle, stacking blocks, as we discussed, stringing beads, working puzzles, dressing dolls, playing with puppets, sculpting with clay, putting together train or car tracks, say, building with Lego or construction toys, playing board games, rolling the dice, moving small pieces, fidget spinners, playing video games using a joystick or other controller, these bursting bubbles. So if you see, this is a soft object, big enough to be able to be grasped by a smaller child, and an older child can go through the fun of being able to pop bubbles. So much fun. I enjoy it to date.
Now, Anita ma'am, I'm so sorry to interrupt, but can you guide me? Am I on the right slide or should I move ahead?
The next slide, 7th slide, please now.
Oh.
Yeah, you asked me just in time, actually. Thank you. So let's take a few minutes to wait through how a child progresses in fine skills, such as holding and using a pencil. I'd like you to take this time to have a look at each, and if you have any questions about the grasp, please ask me. So while you're observing, what I can share with you is that a major milestone of fine motor development is the ability to hold a crayon. A crayon, a pencil, a straw. So basically, a scribble a day brings a writer your way. This is because scribbling is a precursor to actually writing letters. And an expert would call it motor babbling. That is activity. Motor means function, which is movement. This begins at 15 to 18 months. And at this time, toddlers, what they'll do is they will scratch lines across the sheet, and they'll keep doing it on sheets of paper. Sometimes they'll just do one line, they have had enough, then they take another sheet. And you sometimes just wonder, how many sheets of paper am I going to use up? Oh, I don't like it. I think of the environment. Yes, you can, but that's the way children are. Maybe what you can do is you can give the child a crayon and leave the lower portion of your walls lined up with paper or something that is easily erasable. So you can easily clean it, give your child appropriate, say, crayons or chalk, something that you need to be careful they do not put in their mouth. So we have crayons that are generally, you know, very lovely smelling. and we try and give it. But what do children do? They put them in their mouth. So be conscious of when you are handing out such things to your baby. So initially, like I said, they will be scratching and they'll just scribble a little bit. And then gradually by the age of 3, many children would have mastered both the straight as well as the curved lines necessary to write the alphabet. So as we go through, is there any question over here for, in particular for this slide?
No, Anita, ma'am. Kindly all participants, there is a Q&A box, chat box there. You can place your questions over there. For this slide, there's nothing right now, ma'am. Yes. We let have us, one question which we can...
We'll address it later, yes. I will certainly address it. If it's okay, I'll address it later towards the end.
Sure. Okay,
great. So... to progress on to the next slide, what are the skills that we can anticipate at the age of 3? Especially with us eager to get our children now started into the world of school and a lot more learning. It's not just at home that we want the child to learn. We want the child to go and explore the world and be guided by experts, teachers such as you. It is a landmark event. And okay. Is it okay if I wait or I just continue? Anyway, so what are the skills that we can anticipate? It's a landmark event basically for us, isn't it? When we send our child to play school. And I know we do it with a lot of anticipation, yet we are scared. I don't know about you. So as we go on to the next slide, a question for you to think and put down. Why? And I repeat, why are fine motor skills necessary? We discussed them all in the previous couple of slides. So we are on to slide 9. Maybe slide 8 can be shown for a minute so that everybody can have a look. And feel free to share the slides with everyone. I mean, the entire PowerPoint presentation, because it does contain a fair bit of information. May not be new for many, but for some at least. And there are a lot of pictures that you can probably use, which is later on, which we'll run through quickly. These pictures are the ones that you can actually use to come up with more ideas, use your creativity. So as we are on slide 9, why are fine motor skills necessary? And we can see them in the next slide where it says the actual areas that the child has become competent by this age are. Right? So all these we've discussed. Now, some of the ways to help your child develop his muscles and hone his talents. Like I said earlier, why do we need the motor skills? Is because one, to build strength, capacity, capability, coordination, as well as the connect. So the neurons, the what we call nowadays as neuroplasticity, all these things happen at a rapid pace at this age. And the activities that we can do. Now, there is one activity that is generally prescribed, but I would do it with a lot of caution, which is called as tummy time. What is tummy time? Tummy time is basically having your child lie down on the tummy. And there's been research and people who have done it to babies as young as newborns. But the key factor here is to do it minimal. Say maybe maximum for a minute, 2-3 times in a day at the very most, when the child is still a total infant. And gradually, as they themselves develop and they start to turn, that's when you can actually allow them to be a little longer on their tummy. Remember, they are developing, their body is growing and developing, and it needs the appropriate way in which the baby is placed for it to develop as well properly. These are things, if anytime you have doubts, please do consult your pediatrician. Or when you're talking to your school teachers, you can have a word with them, and they can, if they are aware of it, well and good. Or they can also consult with someone and they can very well get back to you and let you know about it. So basically the tummy time helps build the muscles of the back and the shoulders. Because if you see, when the baby is on the tummy, the baby wants to raise its face up, right? And then starting at 8 months, what can you do? You can offer your baby finger food, say maybe nuts, maybe a date, cereal puffs. You can probably give things like these rings, Cheerios, something that they will have fun putting them in their fingers and then popping them in their mouth. It's very much fun to do that. Maybe even a grape for them to be able to squeeze and have fun. Ensure that they are without seeds, because seeds are the one that can actually choke a baby. So you have to be mindful of that. In fact, any of the activities that I suggest here, please be aware that your baby is supervised at all times when given these objects, especially when you're introducing these objects to them before age. So finger foods, we generally are used to giving our babies chips, finger chips. Can we try getting alphabet letters and say air frying them and then giving it to them? And then while they are eating, have them run their finger on the food. And with that, they enjoy not just the eating, but it is also nutritious for them. Plus they learn the skill. So if you are fond of pasta, you can have these done up. You can do these and use them not just to eat, but also sometimes help them string, run thread through it, or yarn of wool maybe. Also, you can, at the age of one, encourage activities that require picking an item and dropping it into a box. Stacking games are also fun and challenging. And at 18 months, you can encourage them to use crayons and even sculpt clay. By the age of two, you can actually enlist your child's help in the kitchen. Ask them to help stir the batter or to cut shapes out of cookie dough. By the age of three, many kids also show an interest in computers. Helping your child master the mouse develops their eye-hand coordination. Also, the basic scissors and glue sticks can be exciting challenges for three-year-olds. So as we progress to the next slide, we find that there are many times that a child does not follow the milestones. We all know that there is an orderly progression to acquiring the fine motor skills, but its pace is often uneven and at times can be interrupted by a fixation at a certain point. Say, for example, while learning to walk, sometimes the baby takes a lot of time to do a particular or learn a particular skill. And as we progress, we see that, when do I need to start worrying and what do I do? Basically, the idea is that you do not need to be too concerned if progress seems slow. And we have all the points listed on the next slide. So what are the red flags? You can see them all over here. So if you'd like to have a read, please go ahead and read it, take a screenshot of it, and probably you might be able to get the PowerPoint entirely. I do apologize for putting too much information on the slide because I generally don't like it, but this is something which I felt would be a good takeaway. So, and you can very well feel free to take the screenshot. Now, remember that when you notice the delays, initially you can continue your breathing easy, but be cautious, be wary, be on the lookout. And when, say, even with some kind of stimulation from your end, the development is not seen, consult your pediatrician. Go ahead and ask them to even examine your baby for all these possible, any possibility that can happen. And this doctor can also refer you to an appropriate professional. Now, as we progress to the next slide, we have some activities here which you can try, which I've already discussed with you. So you can very well have a look. Now, the one thing that I can say is, remember that the child needs organic development first to be able to do any activity. So try not to force or push your child to doing something where you can see that there is a lot of resistance. Or that, suppose, for example, the baby is just 3 months old and you try to make the baby sit on its own without help. That's a big no-no. That's a red flag for the doctor and for the baby. But here it means that you do need to go and consult someone to know when the baby needs to be sat up. That was just an example, basically. Also, remember that if I'm alarmed when I see someone else's baby doing something while my baby is not, please take it easy. Be assured that your baby will do it. Even though we have all these thoughts of saying that maybe my baby's turning into a special child, we have all these fears, don't we? But don't worry. Keep watching, keep being aware. And when you feel that you cannot take it anymore, definitely consult a specialist. So with what are the things that you can do? There are times when baby needs to push up, shift from side to side, and eventually swipe at objects in front of them, both on the tummy as well as on the back. You can, like I said, finger feeding, playing with small items. So they can be encouraged to use blocks, string beans. One of the most beautiful things, and it's there on the coming slides as well, is to give them pincer-like things, clothes, grips, and tweezers. I'm sure all of us have a tweezer at home and we use it regularly, right? So you can start with a big one where they can actually pick up something. For example, even picking up things like a date, things like that, or smaller objects, maybe grapes, they can take and put it in something else. Give them grain. Give them any of these things that they can actually enjoy and keep using their fingers, the pincer movement. Play-Doh, as I said, finger painting. Finger painting is one of the activities that children generally love, especially when it creates a mess. You know, you have these sand trays, you can give that. Give them some paint which is not too harmful for them. Try and look for good quality rather than, or if you feel then you have the food coloring. So prepare your Play-Doh and then add food color to it to give it different colors, and then let them create shapes out of it. So this is what can help. Even paint, which they can actually run through. But of course, like I said, monitor them and ensure that they do not consume any of it. Initially, it will be two-handed tasks, and then gradually it will go to single-handed tasks also. There's buttoning, there's tying, unfastening, practice with clothespins, coloring. Coloring is one activity that they really, really enjoy. Now, I'll give you a few minutes to run through the next few slides. So these are some of the objects that you can use. And we can keep going through this. You can take pictures of these slides because these might give you ideas of what you can do. So the next few slides are, so as you see, the stringing, threading, all these activities are absolute fun. You can actually, using sticks, eye sticks, you can prepare pincers, which are harmless for them. And you can give them the cotton balls that we have, or the pom-poms, small pom-poms, big pom-poms. You can give it to them and give them to actually use it in the pincer grasp and pick and put it. So this is an activity that will keep them very busy. As we go on to the next slide, so these are, remember, candles are there. You can ask them to, on the cake, pastries. They absolutely enjoy this. Even the peeling of stickers and then pasting, these are activities that they enjoy. While the growth is happening, and we'll see in the next slide, that we can also introduce calm and mindfulness along with fun. What is the double benefit? We have these activities, these expandable things. We have bubbles that they can blow. All these can be used. So while they are expanding, so you can also bring about breathing activity. So breathe. It's a double benefit. So you're teaching them mindfulness, yet giving them activity to do. Likewise, if you see on the next slide, you will see one more activity, which is a double benefit. So you can have them run their finger through, as you can see it on the next slide. You can take a picture of this, of course. It's a breathing sphere. And the one thing that I would definitely, definitely recommend is using the 8 figure or the infinity. So if you try it yourself, try and begin with big movements. Do it horizontally, do it vertically if you want, and you can do it with your leg, one leg, and then try and do it with your toes. Same thing, you can do it with your fingers, second finger, third finger. You can do it with each of the fingers, and you will find that you are a lot more balanced. This is one of the brain gym activities that you can give to your child. At the same time, along with doing this, you are ensuring that their breathing is getting regulated. So while they are learning the skills that you're required to learn at that age, you are also introducing social emotional learning, being self-aware, being mindful. Even the one that says butterfly breathing. So you teach them breathing and have them run their index finger going from one flower to the other, and maybe back. You can have them do it with their thumb, forefinger, the middle finger, the ring finger, and the little finger, or the pinky as we call it. And they can keep doing it as many times as they want. And as we progress on to the next slide, you will find that there is a link over here for suggested activities. And maybe if you would like to share it in the chat for all the participants, I'm more than happy to have it be used skillfully. The other thing, as we see on the next slide, is something that I have enjoyed doing it myself, even at this age. We have what is called as a flexagon, and it's as simple as going through the videos. I've given you a list of video links which you can take a screenshot of, or they'll be shared with you in the chat, and just go through these videos and learn how to prepare them and use them to play with your child. So it can be used for mindfulness. It can be used just plain to have fun with them. And it is something which they will never tire of. I didn't get tired. So I kept doing it. I kept doing it, and I kept wanting to continue doing it. One of the best ways in which, when we ourselves are agitated, we can use to calm down. And for the final one, the next one, yes. This has some activities that you can do with your little ones as an exercise. May I request if it's possible to play the video here?
I'll stop the screen share and try to play it. Yeah. All right, ma'am.
Would you like me to share the link with you?
No, ma'am, I'll get it. You can have a animated banter with the participants.
I'm sorry, I was not able to send it to you individually. That's the link in the chat as well. So while the video is being set up, have you ever thought of how you can use this maybe to play with your child? So you see, have them run through this. Please ensure that this doesn't go in their eye. You can have them run their finger on the lines or between the lines, and they can count along the way. So you are doing more than one task at the same time. Have you ever thought of vermicelli? How can vermicelli help you with your child? Maybe you can try and just paste some glue on the paper and then have them pick this up and crush it and then throw it on that. Maybe you can first ensure that you've colored them in different colors, and then you make maybe a flower and then paint, put glue on it, and then have them throw different colors on it. Maybe they can even step on it. So they will get a feel on the underside of their foot. So that is another fun factor which will add to not just their fine, but also the gross skills and maintaining of balance. Very crucial. There has been some research where they say that the gross motor skills are a requirement in order to be able to proceed to fine motor skills. And in a way, they may be in some way, and I repeat, in some way connected even to speech and speaking. Though someone may argue that my baby learned to walk late, but they spoke faster. So it may not be connected. There has been an attempt to research on this, basically. Yes. It does have music as well. So since the link is there, you can very well keep using it. Not a problem. There's more. That's fine. That's fine. It's okay. Please go ahead.
Do you want me to play it again?
A little more. Probably.
Yeah,
sure. There are a few different steps to it.
Sure.
Thank you. So first with the right hand, then with the left hand, and then you try it with both hands, and so on.
Can you try doing it with both? Ready, set, go. Good job. Exercise number two. Make a fist. Thumbs up. Fist again. Peace sign. Let's try it together. Make a fist. Thumbs up. Fist again. Peace sign. Ready, set, go. Try it with your left hand. Ready, set, go. Do it with both hands now. Ready, set, go. Good job. Exercise number three. Open hand. Thumbs down. Open hand. Point with your index finger. Let's try it. Open. Point down. Open again. Then point with your index finger. Ready, set, go. Do it with your left. Ready, set, go. Do both hands now. Ready, set, go. Good job. Use both hands for exercise number four. Clap, palms up together. Clap, handshake. Let's try it. Clap, palms up together. Clap again, and handshake. Ready, set, go. Exercise number five. Handshake. Open your hands and thumbs together. Handshake and clap. Let's try it together. Handshake. Open your hands with thumbs together. Handshake again and clap. Ready, set, go. Guess what's next? It's time for Kinder Egg. Yay!
Remember this? Bubble popping, bubble bursting. We have these bubble wraps. So, questions now. And the video that we just saw, basically it's very useful, not just for special care, it's for any and everyone. I mean, imagine I was trying to do them and I was also making mistakes. So you see, we are all human. Yes, questions please. The first thing that I need to do is to answer, how are things different for my left-handed child? I'm not sure how to guide her with letter formation. So what you can do is, I would recommend one to consult with your pediatrician first, who may refer you to a counselor, or at school, because generally they will gradually learn. So when you show your child how to write with your right hand, face your child. Don't sit with your child, face your child. So when you're facing your child and you're writing, the child will see that and will copy it with your left hand. I found that to be very useful. Pleasure. Anybody else has questions?
Or did any other questions? You can post them in the Q&A section down, participants. I think we have one more, ma'am.
Yes. Yeah. So I had a look at it. If a child learns to walk late but speaks early, no, there is no connection. It's the development of a child. Some children learn to speak faster depending on the stimulation they get, and some learn to walk faster because their development has been faster, or that's what they are naturally inclined towards. So there is no connection as such. But I mean, there are researchers who try and find out if there are connections. Sometimes they meet with some success, sometimes they find there is no connection at all. So at the moment, the consensus is that it's not really connected. Thank you, Manisha. Thank you, Valenciana. Thank you, Sandhya. What could be the reason for delayed walking? Tanvi, what you need to check is the previous milestones. Has there been a delay in the previous milestones also? If so, you can anticipate the child to walk late. Is the child, look at the build of the child. No offense intended here, just I'm talking in general. So you can look at the build of a child. If the child is used to generally sitting, we don't provide enough stimulation. It could be any number of reasons. Just to share with you, even my daughter started walking a little late and I was also concerned, but she did sure enough. Sometimes from what I feel that if the child is more flat-footed, they tend to have a little bit of reticence in terms of walking. They may delay, but they will. All you need to do is be gentle, be kind, demonstrate, ensure that you're giving them enough stimulation in the right direction, and they'll definitely do that. What are the reasons a child dislikes writing? Good question. And I really love this because often we found that the muscles of the children, remember I said the three factors, one is they need eye-hand coordination, they need muscle coordination, and they also need the connect. So when there is some kind of delay, or if there is insufficient stimulation, or if the child's experience in the stimulation has not been a good one, they generally dislike writing. And this process of being able to hold a pencil in the appropriate manner and to write is not as easy and a task as we generally understand it to be, because we ourselves are aware of it. If you see, there are many children who use four fingers when they write. Is that correct? That is still the process. They do need to, from the quadruped to the way they hold the thumb, the index finger, and the middle finger, and then they rest it. So the pencil rests on the middle finger, and then the supporting two fingers are underneath or below that. That is a correct grasp. This is a gradual stage, and which is why we also have what is called as the triangular pencils. Try and introduce those to them first. Even triangular crayons are there. So ensure that the process is gradual rather than instant or sudden, or a force is there. How to deal with a child with temperamental issues? That's a good one. Temperamental issues could also be due to various reasons. First and foremost, you need to get a physical check done whether it is not a constitutional issue. what are the situations that the child is having the temperamental issues in? What could be the stimulating factors? All these factors need to definitely be looked into in order to come to a conclusion for dealing with the child. So initially, when you deal, remember these exercises, the hand exercises, these are generally engrossing and also lead to a calming down. Also, the one where I shared with you the double benefit where you open, close, and then play these. The child may or may not be willing initially, but gradually try and do it. Demonstrate to the child that you yourself enjoy that activity when you're doing it, which is what is going to be picked up by the child and done. Also, has the child been disturbed when doing these activities? So that is instrumental in getting the child to be temperamental. Ensure that first you are mindful, you are calm when you handle, because possibly I rub off my irritation, my anxiety, my worry onto my child, and that is what the child is picking up. When I am calmer, the child will sense it and will gradually do that. And rather than hit the child or to scold the child, reprimand the child, or try and go away from the child, instead, what you can do is just run stroking fingers, stroking hands on the child. And you say, yes, I understand. Yes, I understand. I have found that to be quite helpful in calming the child. And the next thing is to hold and hug the child, because comfort is what? Maybe the child is just uncomfortable doing certain activities. Try and do that. That probably would help the child be comparatively quieter. And continue to follow through. Understand that there could be reasons. Maybe the child is teething. That could be the cause of temperamental. Maybe there could be so many other reasons that the child has all this. All we need to do is understand. If we cannot, try and refer to a specialist, and definitely they'll be able to help you deal with it and cope with it in a better manner. I hope that helps you, Anna.
Yes. Since there are no more questions, is there anyone who would like to ask any more questions?
I see one in the question and answer thing, Nandini. Is it okay if I go ahead?
Yes, please go ahead.
Okay. So it says, Kia asks that some doctors recommend that the child should sleep on their stomach after birth. The question that you can ask your doctor is, how long? Because definitely you are going to play with your child's stomach and intestines if you are going to do it as a constant. Definitely a no-no as far as my knowledge goes, but I would recommend you consult your pediatrician. And as we learned here earlier, a few minutes in a day, which is spread apart, a minute at a time, not longer at birth, at least for a month or two, if not more, because the child will gradually learn to turn. It is a natural phenomenon, and they will do that. There are times when the doctors recommend this, it is due to colic. They say probably that is what will help the child get better. But somehow, personally speaking, I'm not comfortable. Not for a 1 month or a newborn or a 2 month old baby. Yes, any other questions?
Don't see any other questions either in the chat or in the Q&A chat as well.
Yes.
So I take this opportunity, Anita. So thank you very, very much on behalf of ECA Goa for conducting this amazing session for us. We look forward to having more such sessions with you. I don't see Dr. Rita Pays in the panelists because she was supposed to speak. So I now request Ms. Savia Machado, our treasurer, to please propose the vote of thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you, Nandini. Good evening, everyone. In the words of John F. Kennedy, we must find time to stop and thank people who make a difference in our lives. So on behalf of the ECA Goa team, I would like to thank Nirmala Institute of Education, the director, Sister Rita Page, and staff for encouraging and motivating us in organizing these informative sessions for parents and teachers of preschool children. I would also like to thank ECA India for their assistance and guidance throughout, and for sharing their Zoom platform, making it easy for us to conduct the session smoothly. We extend a heart full of gratitude to our esteemed resource person for today, Mrs. Anita Bhutani. Thank you, ma'am, for your valuable time and words of knowledge that you have shared with us. Thank you for enlightening us with simple practical experiences on how we can build fine motor skills in preschoolers. It was a wonderful session and we are surely taking back so much from it. A big thank you to all parents and teachers who attended this session today. I'm sure we all have learned something new that we can put into practice when we are conducting activities to enhance fine motor development in preschoolers. Once again, we extend our gratitude to each one of you. God bless everyone.
Thank you. I'd like to take this opportunity as well to thank each and everyone for a patient ear and for allowing me the length of time to be able to speak and share my thoughts. Of course, this list is not enough. There's a lot more to do. It's an entire course in itself. So in any case, if there are any mistakes on my part, please do forgive me for it. But I'd also like to say that it has been truly a delight being here and sharing this platform with you and actually discussing this through. Should there be any more questions and feedback that you would have, I wouldn't mind and I welcome it actually. So if ECA does have a feedback form and a place where they can actually put their questions, I'm more than happy to receive and to be able to answer them as well. So thank you each and everyone. Dr. Pace is waiting to speak.
Dr. Pace. You can tell me with which username she has joined the session. I will be able to make her a panelist.
N-I-E.
I don't N-I-E. See her. Yes, I am looking for N-I-E Goa in the participant list, but I don't see her.
No, I
her,
think
ma'am.
It will be Myra. Just see Myra Ribeiro.
M-Y-R-A. Yes, all right. Kindly allow me a minute and I will let her have a...
Thank you. Thank you, Reshma. The director of Nirmala Institute of Education will join us now. Yeah, we are very grateful to Nirmala Institute of Education for always, and especially the director, Dr. Rita Pace, for always
Hello.
Supporting and encouraging us. Yes, and you know, giving us all the go ahead every time I meet her, she says, come on, do something for the parents, do something for the teachers. Thank you very much, Dr. Rita Pace, for always being with us and for pushing us forward to do something better. Yes, thank you for all your support and for your cooperation, Dr. Rita Pace.
Yes, okay,
hello, Dr. Rita. Are
yes, I can't get in. Hello.
Can't get in. We can hear you. We can hear you. Please go ahead.
Ma'am, you need to turn on your camera.
Oh, this is not the camera?
It is saying fail to start the video camera.
It's not starting? Okay.
No. Wait.
We can yes, hear you, doctor.
Yeah, here it is.
It's better?
Okay, let it be otherwise.
Thank you. You can speak.
All I want to say is that it's always a pleasure to organize things for teachers of young children. I believe that God trusts all of us so much that he takes us into partnership with himself to develop other human beings, to help other human beings to grow. And as teachers, especially in the first years, you couldn't make a better contribution to the lives of children who will grow into adults and who will take many decisions for people in the country and elsewhere. Because what our primary foundation is what the pinnacle will be. And so therefore to Ms. Bhutani and all those, Anna Coelho, of course, I don't feel the need to thank her because she's part of us, but she's always active. So thank you for organizing this session and for your resourcefulness that you have shared very generously with our teachers. So thank each one of you and God bless you.
God bless you too. Thank you, Dr. Rita. Thank you very much for all the encouragement and the support. I think we can leave the meeting now. Anything
yes,
else?
I just need to make a small announcement. If anyone wants the PPT, I have placed the email of the Goa ECA in the chat box. Please write to us and we'll send you the PPT. And also, if you want certificates for attending the session, please let us know on the same email as well. Thank you very much and have a wonderful evening. Thank you, everyone.
Please post the details for membership on the group, please. Yes, Nandini? How to become a member of ECA and APER. Okay? APER is Association of for Primary Education and Research. Association for Primary Education and Research. We hope all the schools who have participated in this program can become members of this, life members. Okay.
The website.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Can we leave the meeting?